Penguin Random House Canada presents Pluck, a memoir of a Newfoundland childhood and a raucous, terrible, amazing journey to becoming a novelist. By Donna Morrissey. Read for you by the author. For Rick, now you know. Some of you say, joy is greater than sorrow. And others say, nay, sorrow is the greater. But I say unto you, they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at your board, remember that the other is asleep upon your bed. Khalil Gibran, the Prophet. Prologue. If you were a bird flying over the most easterly fringe of Canada, you'd see a great island broiling out of the Atlantic, its granite shores rollicking with fishing boats and flakes and fishermen. A sweep of colored houses faced the wind, smoke whirling from their chimneys, youngsters scrabbling after sheep and hens, and grandmothers scrabbling after youngsters, hiding now within swaths of sheets billowing around them from the clotheslines. Swoop inland, and you'd see the quilted greens and browns of its forests, sequined with ponds and rioting rivers and waterfalls. Should you glide up the 40-mile inlet of White Bay on the northwest side of the island, with its steep wooded hills shouldering the sky, you might hover over a strip of beach with two tiny outports at either end. They're a 5-minute walk apart, and about 10 houses each, separated by a point of land jutting into the sea. Upper beaches and lower beaches. That's where I was born on January 13, 1956. Upper beaches. Or to those on the lower beaches, up on the point. Likewise, we referred to them on the lower beaches as down below. Not much came to us before the late 60s. Televisions, telephones, cars, roads, none of that. Most visitors were fog-bound fishers, the odd aunt or uncle, the occasional young man or woman coming ashore to go courting. Yet, lots came to us in different ways, songs, dances, jannying, yarns spun on the spot and growing with each teller of the tale. No doubt things have opened up since I was a girl. Still, such an environment, culture, and circumstance spawned a uniqueness of character that resides in most of us who grew up there. I never tire of talking about it. It was during an adult education course after I'd graduated university in my 38th year that I started writing. I'd met an older woman named Ellie, who enraptured my mind with stories of skeleton women trapped in bad marriages, who ended up walking the floors of frozen oceans trying to get out. Stories of how we see ourselves, not as swans, but as ugly ducklings. Of how we eat the poison apple of sleep rather than invite spiritual awakening. It was in the midst of one of those tales when she turned to me and said, "You're dragging your own bag of bones, dear. Go find your voice and write your own myth." I bought an alarm clock. Every morning I got up at 6, and before going to work, I'd sit with the homeless in a downtown cafe, writing, writing, writing. I wrote about the pigeons hobbling around on the icy sidewalks beneath my window, the sun rising over the southern hillside, the peonies in my grandmother's garden, the irks and ills of my siblings, of my mother, my father, my grandparents. Until my pen took on a life of its own, and my father became a boy called Luke, my mother a girl called Claire, my brother Glenn a cat called Pirate. I myself would carry many names. I write words spoken by my mother. I write words spoken by my aunts and uncles. I write about what I have seen, heard, and, well, made up. Thus far, it has fed into 6 novels situated in Newfoundland culture, some of those novels undergoing up to 7 translations. When I asked my Japanese editor why her publisher had been attracted to Kit's Law, the story of a girl growing up in a rural Newfoundland outport, she answered, "It is a story of faith, the elderly, and family love. It is what our Japanese culture was built upon, and we struggle now to keep it." It matters not our differences, then, because we all eat from the one basket of life with its fruits of joy, kindness, goodness, and patience. We all speak the universal language of love, laughter, fear, and grief evoked by this tremendous and terrible journey through life. And of the fruits in the basket, it's joy I covet the most, as it allows me to see the beauty in a frost-itched window and hear the singing of broken glass being swept by my mother's broom. And joy is fed by love. It's fed by gratification and blessedness, and it is the seventh heaven. It was the memory of joy that kept me going during my trials of physical and spiritual impoverishment. It was the memory of joy that sustained me through the dark hole I fell into during my 40s. Joy that helped me throughout the hellish battle for sanity in a world suddenly turned on its head. And yet, it was during those moments when joy was blanketed by fear, grief, contempt, guilt, shame, and so many other ills, that I was kicked, bruised, and hurting into consciousness, which is, I believe, where God lives. For our truly conscious moments happen when something, big or small, awakens us to a deeper way of seeing things, dredging us up from innocence into awareness. Looking back, I see those moments, some of them lasting for days, months, perhaps years, as lampposts pinpointing my journey through the dark corridors of my past. This memoir follows a trajectory through some of the more significant of these, leading up to the death of my mother and the publication of my first novel, one that her courage helped me create during her final days. For each moment recounted here, there are thousands more not written. And whenever my personal story becomes lost in my mother's story, it is because she carried me in hers. Imagination. Fear. It came without being beckoned. It came within a flash. It touched cold against my skin, and before I could grasp what it was, it seated itself inside the moist, dark marrow of my bones. I was 8. It was warm and sunny, the ocean lapping along the shore. I was heading for home, proud of the 6-foot slab I'd just pulled from the sea for firewood. It was smelly and water-sogged heavy. When I reached the first house, Aunt Rose's place, she was leaning on her fence, staring down the road. Something was wrong. My aunts were hovering on the road in front of my house. The aunts never hovered in a huddle on the road. They were always inside, doing things. They came out only when a youngster cried too hard, or they needed a bit of kindling from the porch to flame a fire. They'd scoot to another's house for a cup of tea or to borrow a bit of pork fat or butter. They'd team up with buckets and rags and clean the school or Aunt Reen's or grandmother's house if those women were feeling too poorly to do it themselves. They never huddled and hovered in a group on the road. Aunt Rose lifted the latch of her gate and stepped outside. She hadn't been outside her gate in 60 years. She caught sight of me, and her wrinkly mouth trembled. "Your little brother is dead, my love. Your little brother is dead. Seeing, just starting to walk, and now he's dead." I didn't know what dead was. I'd seen a chicken in grandmother's henhouse once that was stiff and dirty and cold to the touch. And grandmother had said it was dead, but baby Paul wasn't a chicken, and he was in hospital because he had a cough. I didn't know what hospital was either. My father bounded out of our house and jumped into his truck, firing up the engine. I dropped the slab. My mother came running too, her sweater half on. Aunt Beat holding the truck door open for her. My mother was barely inside before it jolted forward. I held it in my arms, running. The brakes squealed as Dad rolled down his window, his voice catching on a wet cough as he yelled, "Go home! Go on home now!" They roared off in a flurry of dust from the dry gravel road, the ants wringing their hands and staring after them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.